Well, good morning, Kent Cove. If I haven't met you yet, my name is Dan Shuttler. I'm the pastor of Care and Connections here. And this morning, we are starting a new sermon series over the next few weeks called The Next Normal. Like many, many churches across the country, we have been going through a lot of changes, of course, because of the pandemic and a lot of other things, and we're going through a pastoral change as well, so we kind of need to kind of prepare ourselves for kind of what's ahead. So the next few weeks, we're going to take a look at this through some of the stories in Scripture, and today I'm going to be speaking about the road to Emmaus. You know, as I sat down and I thought to myself, you know, I really like this sermon, but there's no humor. I haven't put any humor in this. So I thought maybe I'd just do this right up front, okay? And of course, this is, so I don't know if I ever told you about my very first job was in a juice factory, but I got canned because I couldn't concentrate. Peter, that's for you. That is for you. And that wasn't for Pastor Corey, just so that you know. All right, let's bow our heads as we prepare to dive into this story of the road to Emmaus. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. Jesus is our living word. And so as we look into this, may this word continue to breathe into us and to live into us that incredible love that you show us, that we may show the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So what a beautiful weekend we have. This was great because at the beginning of the week, it was going to be cloudy and bad all week long. So yesterday it was so beautiful and I sat out on my porch and I was, you know, putting some of my finishing touches on my message. And it was just so beautiful out there and so nice. I kind of lost track of time. And before you know it, I was getting a little sunburned out there. It was just kind of nice. And I just love this time of year when winter is turning into summer, you know. It's that change of seasons. And I love the change of seasons. I was, you know, raised in Nebraska, so, you know, it's imprinted in me, that change of seasons. And I think I'd have a very hard time living somewhere like Hawaii for an extended period of time where it didn't change so much, because I just, that's part of the change cycle that's kind of in me. And some of these change cycles that kind of go over and over again in our lives are called continuous change. Change that we can kind of anticipate, that kind of we look forward to. There might be little kind of things that change, but we know what's going to be happening, right? That's the change of seasons. That's maybe watching our kids grow up, maybe watching us grow up and get a little bit older. Those are kind of the continuous changes that we're going to be talking about here this morning. And that's kind of some of the things that's been happening to Kent Cove over the years, really. Most, but not all, of the changes here at Kent Cove over the years have been into this kind of continuous change category. Each year looking a little bit different than the year before. Changes here and there, responding to different needs in the community and needs in our own little faith community here. So I'm going to kind of talk about that. Now, for those of you who remember things, looking back can be filled with some sort of nostalgia, right? Nostalgia. And that's the reason we keep photo albums and scrapbooks. That's the reason on our Facebook feeds we go, hey, this happened to you 7 years ago. It's this kind of thing. It's a look back. But the problem with nostalgia is twofold. Number one, it's really an incomplete look back. We often forget the bad things. We kind of have a selective memory about what was in the past, okay? And that leaves us ill-prepared and fearful of what is ahead, kind of lacking faith to trust in the who, the what, and the where of how and how God leads us and has led us in the past. And as that relates to the church, I don't think that's where God wants us, to be fearful of the future. Now, looking back is useful, though. It's useful. It's useful to know our history, to know who we are, to try to avoid the mistakes of the past, and to understand who we are. I mean, look at the Israelites. Time and time again, they forgot who they were. They fell into sin. They had to be redeemed, right? So we don't want to be falling into those kind of mistakes. We look to the past so that we try not to make mistakes about in the future. We need to know the past to move forward. And a lot of us who have been around here for Kent Covenant for a while, we know the past, all right? We know 50 years of ministry, two long-term pastors, The birthplace of many who went into missions or are currently pastors elsewhere. The touching of the community in so many different ways. At one point, we had 3 worship services on a Sunday morning. Big, giant ministries, all sorts of things happening out into the community. Things like dessert theater and crosswalk and Easter egg hunts and trunk or treat. Wow, we did a lot. But the thing to remember is we can't go back. We are going into the future. We can't go back, but we can share the message of the past. The message that we have shared all along doesn't change. It just takes new forms. Just like the unchanging nature of God, He never changes. His redemptive power of the risen Christ, the gospel story, does not change. It just assumes a different form. You don't put new wine in old wineskins. Or let's say, like I'm from Nebraska, right? So people grow corn there. So say I was a corn farmer in Nebraska, right, Julie? Right. And then, but one day I woke up and instead of corn in my fields, it was a giant vineyard. It was a huge vineyard. Well, I have all the tools and the implements to grow corn, but none to grow grapes. So if I try to grow the grapes with my corn stuff, it's not going to be like running a combine through the vineyard. Is not going to be, it makes Corey cringe, okay? So, what a waste that would be. What a waste that would be. Now, we are by nature creatures of habit. And so, for some of us, any kind of change can be a little daunting. In fact, even if no one was here, I could probably, if you guys were all gone, I could probably put little name tags of where you sit, okay? I just know that. We all pick our, in fact, on Palm Sunday, when we all sat out there and the doors were open, everybody came in and sat in the same places, okay? That's a kind of a familiar thing for us, okay? But change can sometimes be hard for us. In fact, Mark Twain said, the only person who likes change is a wet baby. Change and is a part of life. It's just a part of life. And change is happening more and more rapidly in our society than at any time in history. Change is inherent in our world. It's built in. And change is necessary for a church that is growing, that a church that is thriving, and a church that is making a difference in its community. And that change can be an energizing force for the power of the gospel and for progress. And if not handled well, it's also a force for stagnation or regression. We need to be cognizant of those two poles. And this is the sort of thing that was occurring in the story of the road to Emmaus in Luke 24. Cleopas and another disciple are leaving Jerusalem after the crucifixion of Jesus. And it's been 3 days since Jesus was crucified and buried. And the men thought that their mighty king was dead. They had this expectation of Jesus being this great liberator, this great Messiah, and he was supposed to establish a Jewish kingdom and throw off the Roman rule. But Jesus did not live up to their expectations, and so they're leaving Jerusalem, they're hurt, without hope, they're sad, they're depressed, they're disillusioned. And this is how the story of Emmaus starts. Now, as I studied this story, I got very, very excited about it. I didn't really know a lot about the road to Emmaus. I mean, I knew about the road to Emmaus, the two disciples that were walking along the road, and then Jesus suddenly appears to them. But after studying this, it's like God is revealing himself to us in a magnificent way, in the new way, through this amazing story. And so let's kind of go through this, and we're just kind of going verses by verses a little bit through this. So let's first is Luke 24, verses 13 through 16. Now, at that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. Now, this is actually the first time in this chapter of Luke 24 where we see Jesus alive. We see Jesus alive. And Jesus just starts walking with him. And the thing that kind of intrigues me here is that they were kept from recognizing who he was. Their eyes wanted to see Jesus, but God restrains their recognition of him. He holds them back. And I think this is because God wants them, the two disciples, and us, to see Jesus not just with our eyes, but in a new and dramatic way. And so, Luke 24, verses 17 through 18, Jesus asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these days?" Okay, so this is like the most hilarious part in the entire Bible, okay? Like, Jesus is the one who went through all this, and the disciple looks at him and says, "Are you the only one who doesn't know what's going on? Really?" But he can't see Jesus for who he really is. So he just thinks, "What? How come you're so clueless about this?" And in Luke 24, 19 through 21, Jesus says, "Well, what things?" "Well, about Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place." And here, as they're talking to Jesus, they reveal their broken expectations. They don't call Jesus the Messiah at this point. They just call him a prophet. A prophet. They've lost faith. They're finding it too hard to believe. It's too dark. Jesus is dead. He must have just been another prophet who died like all the other prophets. He can't possibly be the Messiah that was chosen by God. The Messiah is supposed to come and liberate his people. But Jesus is dead. And the scripture goes on in verses 22 and 24. "In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. But they did not see Jesus." The disciples still couldn't believe this news. By the way, sorry about this, but back in that culture, women were not allowed as credible witnesses, which makes this story even more incredible that Jesus would, that he would reveal himself and the news of the risen Savior would first come through the women. Just amazing. And that, so the guys, they still have a hard time with this. They're having a very difficult time. They're struggling. And when we're struggling, like maybe when we're fatigued or we're frustrated and we can't see Jesus and we can only think of everything that's wrong in our lives, well, maybe we should pause and check our memories. Maybe at that point we're having a selective memory. I mean, how has Jesus done good things for me in the past? How has he shown himself to me in the past? How has he gotten me through the hard times in the past? Sometimes when we're frustrated and depressed, we forget those things, just like these two forgot who Jesus really was and couldn't see him. And we have just gone through the book of Exodus, and we've seen the numerous times that the Israelites had selective memory, right? The challenges in front of them blinded them to God's faithfulness and promise to be with him in all circumstances. So in this story, it's now time for Jesus to answer them. And he actually begins to open their eyes to him, yet not in a visible way, not that easy way, like poof, hey, this is who I am. He doesn't appear to him like that. Instead, he points himself out in the Old Testament. And in verses 25 and 26, the text goes on and says, "He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." So they begin to walk along, And Jesus said, hey, what about this? And what about this? Jesus scolds them for not having hope and realizing what really has happened. And Jesus shows them that he didn't come to be a victorious military or political leader, but to achieve a victory of an entirely different kind, entirely different, and it was through his suffering. Now, this is a very confusing concept of that. They refuse to believe that because it really doesn't say in the Old Testament, and Jesus, who's going to be born of Mary, has to do all these things. It really doesn't say that, but there are prophecies back there that clearly point to Jesus being the one. And a couple of the verses, I don't know this, but I'm pretty sure that he probably pointed out Psalm 22. Psalm 22 has verses like this. My God, why have you abandoned me? Why are you so far away when I groan for help? Every day I call to you, my God, but you do not answer. Every night I lift my voice, but I feel no relief. My life is poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax melting within me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones, and they divide my garments among themselves and throw dice for my clothing. That's Good Friday. That is Good Friday. And Isaiah 53 also has the same prophecy about Jesus. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with the deepest of grief. He was pierced for our rebellion, and he was crushed for our sins. He was beaten so that we could be whole. He was whipped so that we could be healed. And all of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. But he was buried like a criminal. This is the Messiah the Old Testament was talking about. And Jesus is revealing that self to him. You know, that was the tough part for them, to understand the suffering that he had to go through. And suffering is part of our lives too, is it not? No one is immune to suffering in this world. We are born into it. And we will go through trials, and we will go through darkness, and sometimes we feel alone. But God can use that time to draw us near to himself. And one of those ways we draw near is by meditating on and reading these scriptures. Reading these scriptures as how Christ is revealed through scripture. Verse 27 goes on to say, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them that what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And some of these other verses perhaps had to do with, in Genesis, the descendant of Eve who was going to crush the serpent. Abraham's son Isaac carries firewood up the mountain so he can be sacrificed, much like Jesus carried wood across to be sacrificed. Joseph was betrayed by his brothers. Jesus was betrayed by his disciples. Moses was almost killed by an evil king at his birth, and so was Jesus. And Samson gave his life to rescue his people, and so did Jesus. And King David is a good but imperfect king, which prefigures Jesus, who is the perfect king. And as the two travelers listened to Jesus talking, they began to realize that they've missed something all along. That Jesus had come to liberate his people, but not as this mighty warrior, but as a sacrificial lamb. But still, even though they were coming to this understanding, they still couldn't recognize the one who was standing in front of Jesus. But now that Jesus has explained himself in Scripture, they are ready. And in Luke 24, verses 28 to 31, we read, as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going to go a little bit farther. But they urged him strongly and said, no, stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over. So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to them. and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. Jesus pretends to keep going on this trail. But like good hosts in that culture, these two disciples invite Jesus to spend the night. But instead of Cleopas being the servant and being the host for the meal, Jesus assumes that role, the role of the servant. And when he breaks the bread, just like he did for the feeding of the 5,000, just as he did in the upper room, that is when they finally realize. That's when the scales came off. He finally stops restraining their eyes, and they recognize him for who he is as he hands them the bread. Jesus is the host who serves. Jesus, the invited guest, becomes the server in this story. This is the role that he designates for himself. In chapter 22, just a few chapters before, he says, "I am among you as one who serves." Jesus is the one who serves, the one who invites us to the table, the one who pursues us. He pursues us with his love and his grace and his redemption. And that's why thank you, Peter, for programming God With Us song. When we sang that God With Us, those words are these words, that God is with us, that he is among us. When the disciples have understood the proper role of the Messiah, when they recognize the one who serves them a meal as the risen Jesus, the Jesus who liberates Israel not by demonstrating some great power and conquering the enemies, but by serving them with bread. Luke presents two critical notions of Jesus here. Jesus, the Messiah, the one who must suffer, and the role of the servant as revealed in the sharing of the meal. Great, great examples for us. And finally, in Luke 32, it says, they asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked to us on the road and opened up the scriptures to us?" Jesus had just disappeared in an instant. And instead of wondering, "Hey, where'd he go? Where'd he go?" No, they said, wait a minute. "Were not our hearts burning?" They were marveling at what had been revealed to them through the scripture and through remembrance. The burning of their hearts was a signal that they had once again encountered Jesus, and they were changed. Not this big kapow change like Paul on the road to Damascus. That's next week, okay? But this gradual revealing of himself through scripture as they walked along and through the sacrament and the revelation of who he was. And then in Luke 24, verses 33 through 35, they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It's true, the Lord is risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. I just love this scene. They're so excited. They run 7 miles. 7 miles, all the way back to Jerusalem. Find the disciples. "Guess what, everybody, guess what?" And they steal their thunder right away. They said, "Yeah, Jesus is alive. Isn't it incredible? Isn't this amazing? What? Great, here's what we saw," you know? And there's an exchanging it back and forth. And unfortunately, my text for today doesn't go to the next verse. And the next verse says, "And Jesus was with them immediately." So God with us once again. Now, on that road to Emmaus, Jesus joined the two distraught disciples. They didn't recognize him. He pretended he didn't know what was going on. They invited him to rest with them. And when he broke bread, he realized who he was. Finding Jesus in the middle of their confusion, it changed everything for those two lost souls. And it changes everything for us as well. And where is God's plan taking us next? What is next for Kent Covenant Church? What is the next normal? We're going to be examining that the next few weeks, and I'm excited about that. Like the people on the Emmaus Road, as the word is opened to us, then we, perhaps depressed, perhaps suffering, we meet the risen Jesus. The risen Jesus steps off the pages of the Bible and right into our lives. And as we look to the servant who broke bread, who broke himself for us, we meet the risen Jesus, we receive his peace and his mercy and his grace. And we receive the power of the Holy Spirit. We receive his promises to never abandon us as we walk into that future. As I end here, I want to leave us with a few verses from Scripture that reinforce God's promises to us to walk with us into a future that we don't know, because we can't look in the future. It might look fearful to us, but we know that God has been there in the past. We know he's with us now. He is God, Emmanuel. And we know that he will be with us in the future. So as I read these, I invite you to just close your eyes and listen to this scripture speak into your heart. Ecclesiastes 3:1. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heavens. Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and terrified because of them, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Isaiah 43:19. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not see it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Philippians 4:6-7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understandings, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.